original series.
There was a sound that I wanted to go for that was nursery rhymes on steroids. Loud and fast, but they're nursery rhymes. I was hanging out with this girl, and the girl says, "Hey, my brother plays bass." He came over with the bass guitar, and I said, "Here's a riff I had. It's like catchy and intricate, but simple." And he starts pounding away on the bass. The music just worked. The band exploded and was really big, but I sensed that there was ways we could experiment musically. That realization was like a nuclear bomb. You look at a human being and you think you know who they are because what, you listen to 6 records? How do you see yourself? How do you see the world? And what does that look like as an animation? What does that look like as a song? That journey is way more important to me than fame or money. I look at my whole life bucket of art and I go, there's a lot of shit in there now. In the 7th grade, my buddy moved away to Oregon. There was a week where I went up to go visit him in Portland. I flew up there by myself, go to his house, and the whole thing was, hey, he's going to be in school on some of these days this week, so you can shadow him to school, or you can hang out until he gets out of school. I shadowed him one day, and I was like, this is fucking weird. I'm going to stay at your house and wait. But in his room, there were 4 things that were very important. A Stiff Little Fingers record. There was a All record. A Dinosaur Jr. record, and there was an electric guitar. So what I did was I would play those 3 albums on vinyl, and I would go over and pick up this guitar to keep myself entertained throughout the day for those 3 or 4 days that he would be at school until he'd come back and we'd skate at night and do whatever. That changed my life, you know, changed my life. The hearing punk rock music and picking up the guitar, something clicked where it's almost like there's a bunch of gasoline on the ground and someone flicks a cigarette and it just ignites. You know, it's just, it was a chemical reaction that just flipped on a switch that nothing could take that guitar out of my hand from that point forward. Out of, you know, with the 3 guys in Blink 182, I was the only one that was born and raised in San Diego. It's an interesting place because it's the only place in the world probably where the idea of quality of life and is more important than, you know, quantity of life. So music and surfing or skateboarding and being healthy and watching the sunsets, you know, and growing up and trying to stay young and be happy, you know, we're known for that. Skateboarding was my first passion. I mean, I remember when I got my first skateboard, 5th grade, that just like changed my life. I think growing up in a somewhat broken family, that's looked at as like your first car. That was the first thing that can take me away from my house really fast and really far, and I put that to good use. At that time, skateboarding was becoming a culture. It was becoming a rebellion against organized sports, organized family life, you know, and organized interests. the great thing about that culture, at least in San Diego, skateboarding and punk rock music, all that was kind of, you know, one thing. You skateboard and you listen to punk rock music. That's one type of individual. And the more unique you are and the weirder you are, the better you feel about yourself. It was the one kind of thing you can be involved in where the more of an outcast you were, the better and you felt about yourself. And that's what I loved about the whole punk rock scene. You know, skateboarding was the great conduit to find out about new music. Mostly for us, it was the song in the video. So when the pros came out with their parts, they usually would pick dope new bands to put in there. And I was listening to bands like Big Drill Car and all these bands that were kind of from the LA County area and that were all built around Cruise Records, SST Records, what people, my fans might know of, like the Descendants and all that kind of stuff. But the pro skaters were putting in all this really cool punk rock music, and then that would make us blast it when we went skating, and that would make us go downtown if the band came around on tour. Around that time, punk just started exploding. And now these little bands, they're coming to town, and it's a band called NoFX, and 3,000 people are showing up, and it's about ready to, the building's about ready to collapse with energy. And I remember going down there and just going, holy shit, this little punk rock skateboarding world is like about to take over the world, you know? And that was a really fun thing to be a part of. Growing up in a neighborhood where you went to school with all these guys, and after school you skated with these guys, it was a really cool place to grow up. This street we're on right now, I would run across it naked with my friends. When we got to the other side, we're standing there naked laughing, and we looked back this way, and in that two-story house right there, my friend's dad was in the window watching us. He had to put his underwear and pants back on, really bummed, walk across the street and go get busted by his dad. We would take old clothes and stuff them with newspapers and staple the clothing and make a body, and we would throw them at guards. We shot my friend with a paintball gun right here. He did an endo on his bike. We'd ride through Kmart on our skateboards and knock everything off the aisles. I got stuck on that roof one time. Right inside that building right there, I did chewing tobacco for the first time. Fell over, nauseous, puking my brains out. The gym would be open for people to play basketball every night. And we'd wait till it gets dark, and we'd go up there and cut the power. There was a really cute girl that lived right here. She wouldn't talk to me. I almost lit a house on fire inside this neighborhood. Me and my friend thought it'd be fun if we lit a gallon of gasoline on top of someone's garage. I toilet papered some very famous baseball players' houses. We just passed a house where I lost my virginity. My best friend was his sister. We'd sneak down to the shopping center down the street and shoot people with paintball guns. They would hold an all-night relay to raise money. We didn't want to run fucking laps, but what we did want to do was hang out in these trees way back there and launch water balloons at them. We were kind of assholes. Wasn't a bully, but you're just always getting into trouble when you have nothing to do, you know? Because we didn't play sports, and I never wanted to be at home. So we'd do anything we could do just to entertain ourselves. You know, there's an old story. Bono from U2 said when they, as a band, or wanted to be a band, but they were very insecure about it, they saw the Ramones play. And after they saw the Ramones play, he describes this kind of aha moment that, oh my God, we can do that too. It's no longer about how good you are on guitar or what your chops are on the drums. It wasn't about musicianship, it was about emotion. And the band can be a vehicle to emote something, and the complexity of the music has nothing to do with the emotion. That made a lot of sense to me, because I remember the moment that happened to me when I went to a punk rock show, and you had all the big ones at this one kind of little festival. Face to Face was doing its thing, NoFX was there, and they were so funny. NoFX in particular, and it was so raw. I mean, they would stop a song and point at each other and try to figure out who fucked up. And I was just like, wait, you can do that, you know? You know, they would just make up a song on the spot. It was X-rated at times, and it was pathetic at times, but it was always like charming and authentic. I walked away from that event specifically saying, I didn't know music could do that. I didn't know that it could be a celebration of who you are as a person and who you hang out with and what you think is cool and how you dress and how you're rebelling against all the organization that you're taught to grow up and be a part of. And I remember at that moment, I go, that's me and my buddies. There is no difference between this and how we are on any given day. They're just doing it on stage with a big PA system, but they're being themselves, and those guys that they are the same guys I know, you know? The big difference was I'm no different than these guys, except I really suck. Like, I need to get quite a bit better. I didn't have anything that could be turned up and anybody can hear. I didn't have any equipment. I didn't have a plan. But I would, that's all I need is a spark, and then I can move on it. I had to go to church back then, and they had instruments at church. And I would always pick up the guitar, and I was so feverish about it, like after hours or whatever, that a couple friends, they pieced together a really shitty old guitar that probably cost $13, but it worked. That became the tool of the very first songs that I ever wrote, which were all about a girl that was older than me that I liked a lot, most of the songs. Some of the songs were about, poop and butts and stuff like that because I thought it was funny. I knew right off the bat when I picked up the guitar that I should do something simple and I should do it over and over again. But trying to understand a sound that I identified with and that I liked, that didn't happen until I got heavily into the Descendants and all. I started to identify a tonality that really worked with me. That was like, it's full of energy, it's full of rebellion, it's really fast, it's not complex, but it's melodic. But you're singing about things that you can relate to. There was a sound that I wanted to go for that was nursery rhymes on steroids and meth. Loud and fast, but they're nursery rhymes. And that's where the genesis of the sound of Blink-182 started. So when I'd play guitar, I would go as fast as I could, just trying to get it out, and I'd release the emotion, and I'd fall asleep in my room. And I did that until I got kicked out of high school.
My love life was getting so bland. There are only so many ways I can make love with my hand.
So I go to this other high school, and they had a battle of the bands, and I saw this little eighth grader come up, and he was like a good drummer. Afterwards, I walked right up to him. I was like, dude, we should jam. And he was like super young. He's like, okay. And that was Scott Rainer, the first drummer of Blink. So now I'm in a and meeting Scott, and we're jamming in his room in Poway every once in a while. And then at that same school I went to, I met this girl, and I was hanging out with the only like three skateboarders in the whole high school. And he started dating this girl, and the girl says, hey, my brother plays bass. He's moving down here from Ridgecrest. And this was Mark's sister, Anne. So I met Mark, and it was funny. He came over with the bass guitar, and we sat in my garage, and I said, here's a riff I had. And he starts pounding away on the bass, and it just like, he played the exact same way I play guitar, which is you can either strum or you can do a lot of downstrokes, a lot of downstrokes. It's a very Descendants kind of thing to do, and we were both just giant Descendants fans. So the music just it just worked, and next thing you know, he comes over and we're playing.
The other night, I caught her with her brother in her bed.
With her brother in bed.
Five arms, 10 legs, and 4 toes.
Fuck your family,
I guess that's just the way
This is my house that I grew up in. I lived in the garage. When Blink started, my biggest dream was being big enough to play on my street in front of neighbors. Like, what if I played and neighbors came out and thought I was cool and, like, I was, like, on a stage or something? Not long after that, when we started playing our first shows, my manager and I were walking, and he goes, well, what's your goal? Like, what's the goal you have? Like, what do you want? What do you desire? And I said, I would just about die if I had the shot at playing 2,000-person club capacities, like, just clubs, you know? That would be infinitely beyond any dream I could possibly have, just a couple thousand people. No one ever thought that, like, well, what if you sold 30,000 tickets a night? You know? That's like, you mean with dick songs? Like, really? That can happen? But it all started here.
Blues Records is a very important place. It was the most famous record store in San Diego and one of the most famous in the country. When Blink first started, I drove around about a 20-mile radius from the store and I broke into every high school at night. And I made Blink flyers and I put them in every single locker at all these high schools that we were playing at the club downtown. At that point in time, everyone in San Diego wanted to support their local bands. It was just a really big scene. So because I put those flyers in those lockers, we ended up having our first show at a big club. All the people came, and we had enough people that watched us that the guy that owned the club invited us the following week to play on the big stage. So what we did is not only played that show, we rushed and made a really quick recording, and it was our first recording with a little Buddha statue on it. People commonly refer to that record as Buddha. We made that to sell here in this store. So we would put 5 tapes in at a time. It was in the time where tapes were selling. And every week we would call up and they're gone. And we're like, oh my God, so we put 5 more, they're gone. So then we gave them 10, they're gone. And then we gave them 20. Next thing you know, we sold thousands of these tape cassettes out of Lose Records, and then we got our start. It was, little suburban kids, we had a dream to be in the punk rock section. And I'm here now looking at all these things I grew up on, and it was so insanely important to me. All, this was my jam. This is how I got into music. If you listen to All and take out the more progressive songs they got and just listen to the pop punk stuff, you'll see where Blink came from. And it was the same band as the Descendants, but, you know, obviously there's no Descendants records in here because it's really fucking good. This is one of the most important records that has ever come out of the punk scene, Fugazi. When this came out, everyone was like, oh my God, we can be good too? We can be good musicians? You know, so no effects. They're funny. They're a very funny band. But they would get more political, but they always stayed funny too. But that was kind of a thing. GBH. Now, GBH has a song called City Babies Attacked by Rats. So I used to go into high school blasting that with my brother. City Baby, attacked by rats. City Baby, attacked by rats. And we'd have all these like popular girls and jocks like stopping. You would hear us blasting this through the parking lot. We were little derelicts back then.
In this studio, this room specifically, we were putting together our first well-recorded songs. And Mark had this song. And he just had this thing that was the most basic chord progression that we've used 1,000 times. Just doing this. And he came in and he goes, what if I did a riff over it? And it's the most simple song. It starts with a riff and it goes into muted power chords. It's all right to tell me. I remember, wow, that was some catchy shit. But it was the arrangement of the song that changed the band. the chorus and then the bridge. And then all of a sudden the chorus came back in, and then the riff came back in, and it says, well, I guess this is growing up. There's something about that riff saying, I guess this is growing up, and the architecture that never left me. From that point on, we're like, we know how to write a song. Everything up till that point was like, these are punk rock little art pieces, spastic and searching for a soul and or an epicenter or a foundation, you know, like who we are. But when we hit Damn It, we figured out right away who we are. You know, the Tom sound started out with, you know, a guitar that had a very overdriven pickup. And what that means is that anything you play is really loud and with a lot of feedback and all these overtones that can hide mistakes. But it doesn't sound great. It's very specific, and it covers up as bad of a player as you want to be. I was always more interested in saying stupid jokes, yelling obscenities, trying to make fun of Mark's mom or whatever. And likewise, to us, it was about who we were and how fucked up we were as people. It wasn't about the music, you know. It's like, the music is just what got all you guys here to look at us say stupid jokes. You know, like, that gives you a reason to buy the ticket, but we'll stay up here and do some stupid shit, and you might think that the ticket was possibly worth it. But what you see over the years is learning with all of us how to fill in the space with only three players. And I think we got pretty good at that. But the cool thing with only having three players is there is a lot of space to do extra stuff. So when you listen to the first things that Blink ever did, you'll hear one riff with a very straightforward beat. But you'll hear this kind of evolution where the riffing continued throughout the whole song. Power chords got used more sparingly, and the drum beat wasn't just going along. It was doing these fantastic rhythms and beats and stuff that gave it a groove, stuff that gave it a trance, stuff that made you want to bob your head a little bit, and converging all these different ways of just being three guys into a simple song was really the special thing that band did. It took quite a few records to figure out how to do that well. And I think Enema of the State was the beginning of us cluing in on exactly who we were. When I wrote Dumpweed, it was just kind of a collection of riffs. I had this one riff that went And I had another riff that went And then I was like, but wouldn't it be cool if we sang over something that was very nursery rhyme? And it was just kind of this, I don't know, very childlike and fast. So what we did is we combined all the riffs and we created this big kind of hello intro for the record that was our first really big record. And to this day, it's probably the best opener we've ever had. And it goes like this. Right when you turn on Enema of the State and you hear that song Dumpweed, it's a very riffy nursery rhyme song that just sounds, it's like catchy and intricate, but simple. And, you know, I think that was a good way to give an introduction to the next part of, you know, of where we're going. I I think, you know, Travis coming into the band had a lot, it was magnificent. You know, we go through all of our records and we get to NMA the State and we finally have a good producer. We finally have a real recording budget. We're gonna spend 3 months on this stuff. And we know how to write a catchy song. I remember there was this one time we were writing in this little hot room, and I think Travis was frustrated, and he came up to me and he was all, "Why can't you write something that's not just like straightforward, just normal? I mean, I'm playing the same beat each time." And I go, "Well, I'm not a fucking groove expert. That's your job. You're a kick-ass drummer. Why don't you tell me like how to play something that's rhythmic?" And I remember he looked at me and this light bulb went off, almost like, "Oh, well, I can play whatever I want. And then you might even change what you're doing to fit my thing if I have a rad idea, because then I might just play something kind of straightforward that if you weren't Travis, you would just play a normal beat." But he goes, "Well, what if I flip it around and the snare starts off the beat?" And I'm like, "Oh, then I wouldn't go straightforward. I would make this more rhythmic and I'll throw in a little note here or there so it's not just power chords." And something that's super simple became kind of clever. And that realization was like a nuclear bomb in the studio. That was everything. That was like, we got a third songwriter in the band. You know, it wasn't just Mark and I coming up with little ideas. The three of us were really interacting, you know? It was my 18th birthday, and I come home, and there's like these scratch marks all the way across the sidewalk from the front door out to the driveway. And I walk home, I was like, "What the hell are all these scratch marks?" And I followed them from the driveway up to the front door, opened the front door and all the furniture is gone. Someone dragged the furniture out. And I realized that my dad moved out right at that moment. It was the 20th anniversary of my parents, and everything just, all hell broke loose on that day. Like anybody, you know, it would affect you to see your parents break up like that. I wanted to tackle that in a song. Stay Together for the Kids. It was a simple thing, but I think the magic of it was that was all pretty, but I wanted to do something we never did before, and that was on the chorus, turn on all the pedals. I think we hit on something that sounded like adolescents lashing out over being caught in the middle of a storm that they had no control of. You know, you grow up thinking that your parents are more powerful than they are. They know a lot more than they do. And as you get older, you start to learn they're just people too. They're about as vulnerable and as, you know, destructible, you know, as you are. And I think that's what's great about rock and roll. It's not about the music as much as it's about the emotion. And the emotion is what resonates with people. They feel something. I think sometimes we lose sight of that importance. When you're a musician, you get caught up in the business, you get caught up in the work, you get caught up in the fame or whatever, and then all of a sudden someone slaps you upside the head with reality, you know, and you're like, wow, you know, art is really important. It's just really super important. We were coming out of two gigantic records with Blink-182. We were exhausted. We were overworked. We needed space from each other. I've been doing at that point, you know, I don't know, 5 or 6 records that were all that kind of similar sound. I think out of insecurity, I sensed that musically there was cooler things that we could do. But I didn't really know what those were, you know. I was a massive fan. I have always been a massive fan of Fugazi. They were the Radiohead of punk, you know, where everything they did was forward thinking, credible, and mattered. And they were really fucking good. So I knew that I loved bands like that too, but that I felt they weren't showing through in the Blink music. And I wanted to figure out how to have that come through, and I didn't know how. So I took advantage of a break that we had to go challenge myself in a number of different ways. Can I figure out how to make those influences come through? Can I do it on my own? Am I capable of doing something good without the other guys? That could be a crutch, you know. Blink's big and I have two great musicians I play with. Could I do something that's good without those guys? I like those types of challenges, not because, you know, it wasn't because I wasn't satisfied or I was wanted to be some, you know, solo artist. I like to challenge myself mentally, you know, artistically. I'm just wired that way. And that is way more important to me. That journey is way more important to me than fame or money or anything. That's why if you look at my career, with everything I do, from companies and music and doing movies and stuff now, it's like I'm always doing something completely new, you know, wondering if I can do a cool version of it. But at the time, Boxcar Racer was that. So what that meant was, you know, what are those influences? That meant heavier guitars. That meant really dynamic parts that were like quiet and then get really loud. That meant singing about things that were somewhat political, because I was a huge conspiracy theorist at that time. I mean, I love that. And the reason I like conspiracies is because it's like a bunch of things that it's a treasure hunt to figure out what's really going on. You get little pieces of information, you know, and you try and assemble it. And I was so into all that stuff. So I was like, how do I take all these other parts of me? You look at a human being and you think you know who they are, because what, you've listened to six records? You know, I wrote six songs on six records, you know, like, so you know everything about me. No, I mean, I love politics and I love astrology and I love the universe and space and physics. I'm enamored by physics and how science works. You know, there's all these things that I'll do that no one knows, but with Boxcar Racer is like, how do I start walking in that direction and bringing some of those things out? And that translated itself into a record that was extremely emotional for me. And the reason was, I was out to prove something to myself. I was out to prove something, I think probably to the world, that I was capable of something. But there was a problem. I hurt my back really bad at the time. I broke my first disc. So I got really, really on painkillers. Like huge. But I remember the first time I went to the doctor and he walked in and saw my big x-ray on the wall and he goes, oh my God, you got a big herniated disc. Well, it's sticking like that far out of my fucking spine. And he goes, well, we gotta get rid of the pain, because the pain was so bad that I would literally fall on the ground in tears. I couldn't stand up for more than like 4 minutes, 5 minutes. Well, what we found out was is the disc was broken and tangled up in the biggest nerve in my body. So it was sawing through a nerve this thick called the sciatic that goes down your hips and into each leg. So during that record, insecurities and passions and trying to prove to myself and the world and everything else that goes into a weirdo like me surfaced into a record that was probably one of the more brilliant records I've been a part of in my career. I think I accomplished what I was looking for, but I figured out a new way to write music. Blink 182, you know, it started literally with these two things on Cheshire Cat. You know, that's all I used. It's funny because on the following album, A Dude Ranch, this guitar moved over to this head, and what I ended up doing was using both of these amps. But then when I went and did Boxcar Racer, I felt like this was like tiny. I felt like this was more of a like a violin on a 6'4" dude. I put this here, and this is the guitar that started my change, where that was cool. There was so much more craftsmanship in this guitar. Semi-hollow body, so it has a fuller tone and it just feels more like an acoustic where you feel the guitar vibrating, but it was bigger and it felt like a work of art in itself. So once I decided that that's what I wanted to play, I got my own model. The whole chocolate brown, the racing stripe, is kind of retro, it's kind of thrift store. Sounded great in the studio, it sounded great in a live show, it sounded incredible playing these 1052 strings. But after a while, I realized that I didn't like how glossy it was. I didn't like how new it was. So I got rid of just having a normal paint job, and I started spray painting my own guitars and burning it. But you got to be careful, because when you light this on fire, the paint will, like, it'll explode. You have to be professional at vandalism to get this effect. It just looks fucking cool. Looking cool is like 90% of all music. It might even be 93%. I've always been a fan of hardcore punk. So when you look at punk rock music, there's like kind of different branches of the tree. The hardcore kids is a much heavier thing. It was almost like living in between fast punk and fast metal, but there'd be these big grindy parts. So what happened after that, though, was this kind of post-hardcore movement where you didn't need to be screaming all the time and you didn't need to be super speedy all the time. You had the melodic stuff from the punk rock kind of that you loved and grew up knowing, but it was done in a much more adult, darker, or more aggressive way. And that really resonated with me. So I instantly was like, well, how do I do that? How do I go from writing really catchy, fast guitarists to something, you know, much more heavy? And the first song on the record was a song called All Systems Go. And that song was the first one that Boxcar Racer wrote. And we said, holy shit, you know, we're really on to something with this. The riff was started out with something that you might think Blink would do, where it's going. It was just this kind of droney thing, but then this fill comes in and it goes. And then it sunk down into these verses that were like super kind of groove. That to me was like, okay, this is what really interests me. So what we did was, a lot of it revolved around drum sets. We would record the big, heavy guitar parts with these big drum sets, you know, and then we'd come down to the verse where it's quiet, and we did this one little mic on a little drum. So it was tiny drums to big drums, tiny guitar to big guitar. So when you listen to the Boxcar Racer record, it's so dynamic. It was really cool because I felt that we were doing something that was really unique for the punk scene, really unique for my kind of songwriting career. There was an art form, there was a craftsmanship of that record. The recording process, it was crafted to have dynamic change and unhindered emotive potential. I learned so much from that. That's really what changed my entire perception of what could happen on a Blink record. We came out of that and we moved into the Untitled record, which is kind of the more famous Blink record that we got. That's why there was such a transformation of the band. I went away to college, you know, and I came back and said, I've been illuminated. I have some ideas. This is where we can go. And by no means was it just me. I just think that I know for what I was responsible for, I was able to completely transform and give a lot more to help at least, you know, be a spark to start the fire. But I think everyone on that record specifically was feeling that's what was needed, and in their own way, everyone brought that to the table. This is just on my story. That's the quantum leap with, you know, a lot of those songs and tonalities and ideas and all that kind of shit. It came from that experience on Boxcar Racer. There's a whole second side of the Boxcar Racer story. So we're doing the record and I need someone to play drums. I call up Travis because he's a buddy and he's a friend. And yeah, okay, so Travis comes in and plays it. Well, it turns out the record's pretty fucking dope. And then we're like, well, shit, we should tour it, and you know. And then what we didn't think through was the way it may or may not look to the band of Blink, because I think people were so passionate about Blink, and the press starts to get weird, like there's some rift in the band, or we're trying to start a new band. It wasn't any of that. It was like we just painted a painting and wanted to show people the painting. So coming back, you know, after that, there were insecurities and issues within the band, and that started this long path of awkwardness, something that was totally benign. And making a dumb phone call to one guy to play drums created a lot of weirdness and suspicion and conflicts politically, you know, within the band. And it wasn't meant to be that way. So, but at the same time, I think everyone was definitely realizing, though, we were still doing our best shit we ever did. So I think it was really difficult emotionally. It's like, I'm really pissed at this whole thing, but yes, the music is way better. And we, you know, so it was a little bit of all that, but then it all came to a head where, you know, it just didn't seem like the same band anymore for me, with all the awkwardness and suspicion, because of Boxcar Racer. All of us overworked and exhausted, because I should have just taken a fucking break. You know, I probably shouldn't have written another record. You know, I'm a father, and I'm starting to miss that San Diego lifestyle, the sunset and the beach and laughing and beach cruisers, having fish tacos and laughing and seeing each other all day long, and, you know, and having like a life, a neighborhood life in the best place ever. I didn't have any of that. And I'm looking all around me, and I don't even recognize my band members. And I don't even know if I recognize myself, you know? I took the chance to walk down a completely different path, which was like, you know, it was the hardest thing I've ever done. But my God, I found myself. I completely found myself.
If you live in San Diego, the beach is kind of everything, and you kind of end up very early on in your life will learn the kind of healing properties of just being near the beach. You lose somebody in your family, you know, like when my father passed away, the first place I went was a park to the beach. When my mom went through the big divorce with my dad, she came to the beach. I remember when we started Angels and Airwaves, that happened at the beach as well. I remember sitting on a picnic table right up there overlooking this cliff and trying to, you know, I was sitting with my friend David and I was like, I just want something that's more, you know, positive and aspirational. I wanted to be inspired. I wanted to inspire other people. And I wanted to do something that was very artistic. I wanted to do something that was progressive. I just wanted to hang out with people that valued, you know, what I brought and what my goals were, and likewise me about them. And then it was at that moment that we said, well, hey, let's start another band, you know? And so we came up with this Angels and Airwaves idea that was more than just a band, it was an art project.
If you look at, you know, the body of work that I've been doing, it started out with something very simple that was full of angst and rebellion. Then I tried something with Boxcar Racer that was a way to take the musicianship a little bit further, to try and do something that was more mature songwriting, more mature and dynamic. When I started Angels and Airwaves, the logical progression was, how do I take the idea of emotion and angst and rebellion, you know, keep those attributes, but how do I incorporate more of a mature recording process and the dynamic recording process, make the recording craftsmanship part of the songwriting? How do I combine all these things that I've learned, but how do I then transform it into something new? So what I did was I said, well, if I'm going to think about the ethos and the kind of building blocks of what this art project was going to be, it all seemed very hopeful and inspirational. And what was music that would do all those things I described, but also do these kind of new adjectives that I felt it needed to be? And it felt like the music needed to fly, it needed to soar, it needed to be able to lift off the ground and do its thing. So the best way I could do that was to play the same way that I've always played, but I wanted to do something that would kind of augment my natural style of playing. So I started playing around with the delay pedal. Thing about pedals is some sound really good and some sound really shitty, but you're cool with either. Sometimes the fact that it sounds shitty is what makes it cool. What you learn very quickly is sometimes the coolest pedals are the ones that look the weirdest. Like here's a guy, there's like a little guy with the middle finger stretched out. You know, I look at that little cartoon drawing and I'm like, fuck, what does that do? A lot of times these are made in garages. You know, you just have a guy making his own little transistor box thing, and he puts a piece of metal over it, spray paints it, and maybe all it does is it opens and closes the signal, so it goes da, 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 you know, or maybe it echoes the signal. Either way, it's a fine adjustment on the tool itself, which is the guitar tone. I could play the same riffs I always play, but they start to bounce around and become trance-like and become atmospheric. And it sounds spacey, you know? Sounds like, I like space. I've always been fascinated with space. I always tell people this, because it's one of my favorite quotes. If space is infinite, like there's no end, there's no fucking end to space, then it's infinite the possibility, you know? Anything you think of right now could be happening because it's that big. And that was always really exciting to me because I'm kind of wired to be an optimist. And when I started playing guitar with these types of rhythmic trance-like echoes, I started to feel that way. I started to feel like I was floating through space. First thing I did is I set up the studio in my house so I could be at home for the first time. And then I put up these big television screens and I was playing all science fiction films like Blade Runner, or 2001, or like anything that was visually stunning. But then I also had these Stephen Ambrose books, these big coffee table books, World War II pictures. And I kept going over there looking at the space movie and then looking back down at the World War II photos and back to the space movie. And I was like, wow, that juxtaposition's gnarly. You know, like, you know, here's like the Earth horizon and the sun coming up and it's so beautiful. And then here's guys in a ditch, bodies everywhere. And I'm kind of going, is that the same place? You know, Earth does both those things. And I said, what would it sound like with marching, you know, coming into the song? Or what would it sound like if it sounded like a battalion of tanks rolling in as the song starts? And Critter, which was my engineer and co-pilot on all this stuff, and he pointed to a file cabinet. And he's like, let's just slam that file cabinet shut, open and shut. And I was like, all right. And so he grabs a mic and does it. And it's just, and you just hear the mechanics and this kind of grinding, like metallic noise with a slam. And he put it in there and he did his thing to it, pitched it down. The next thing you know, when it's happening in a rhythm, it just sounded like a million troops stomping on your face. And I was like, oh my God. You know, I've never heard something like that in a song. And next thing you know, we were doing that on all the songs. We found something that was unique to do, which was, you know, it's sound design. You see it in movies all the time. It's sound design, but sound design crafted into a song. And four songs into that writing, we wrote a song called The Adventure. And that was a life-changing moment for me. We put some rocks in a shoebox and we rolled the shoebox around with all these pebbles. You know, and then we grabbed that and created a rhythm out of it. And so when we added some stomps and this rolling box of rocks, it created this grindy kind of rhythm. And then we added a riff to it that was a very simple riff, kind of sad sounding. But I didn't know what I was going to play for the main song, you know, so we started with the rhythm, then put a riff, and I was like, okay, so where does it go from here? So I stomped on the pedal in time, and I was for hours straight sitting at the computer, and I think there's footage of this, of the documentary we made. Maybe you can show it right here.
Where does this need to go? bringing some rhythms underneath that thing, but it's what happened right here is what's throwing me for a loop.
Right.
If we go into some other
kind of... I'm sitting at the computer, and it just kind of starts to happen. Here, it's a little dry. On the song, in the moment, it was something that gave you the chills up and down your arms. And I remember stopping and looking at Critter, and I was like, holy shit, we got something. I remember during writing the words, actually, because I had a friend whose wife left him. Just figured that she can find something better, and he loved her. I remember him saying, I don't know if you'll ever know what it's like to love somebody so much more than they will ever love you, is what he said to me. So I remember feeling so beat up from everything I was going through with the whole Blink situation and trying to find a new identity and all that kind of stuff. And then my friend says that to me, and I was like, fuck then. We're gonna make a song that makes you feel like you can conquer the world. That night, after I sang it, I remember sitting in the studio at 2 a.m. It was at my house, my family's asleep, and I was listening to this thing, and about halfway this song, I had these tears in my eyes, and I felt like there was something magical happening. That happens to me every once in a while, where I'm a part of something artistically where I get kind of overwhelmed emotionally and feel like I'm really on to something that's important. Not that I think it's like great or better than anything else, or that it's going to be something giant or big. It's because I feel like it touches on something that's important to me, and it like grabbed a hold of like a nerve, and it's just gripping it, and I could feel it, and it's like electric waves through your body. And it doesn't happen on every single thing, but it happens every so often, and you kind of go, wow, this is what I was meant to do, was this one little thing, you know? And that song was one of them. Angels and Airwaves was all about landscapes. It was all about setting a rhythmic landscape, and the song comes up slowly and crescendos and attacks you without you really knowing it was happening. You know, that was kind of in my mind the picture I was trying to paint. But what I was doing as well is I was just looking at really big bands. I was over the small, cool bands. I was like, how does U2 do it? How do the Police do it? How does the Cure do it? You know, how does the Who do it? What are they all doing right that all the other bands missed? There's an element of showmanship. There's an anthemic quality. There was a soul. I was bouncing off the walls trying to find my own way. But we eventually got to the end of the hallway, you know, where we figured out who we were. And I think that really happened somewhere around the Love records. We were confident in who we were, and now we were moving on to try a motion picture, you know, where we can kind of step off the music and try the next big part of the idea. It took us a while to get there. It's a big task to say, hey, let's make a double album and a feature film. I wanted to tell it visually. I wanted the music to be cinematic. And so we started trying to get really big visual themes with the music. The effect was a cinematic experience, and we started to do that. The idea was that Angels and Airwaves is an art project to take large themes about the human race and communicate them on different mediums. And for the first time, I felt like Tom DeLonge. I didn't feel like Tom from Blink. So even when I came back to the band, I still felt like Tom DeLonge. You know, Blink just felt like this thing. It didn't feel like my thing anymore. It didn't feel like the band. It was always like, it was its own thing, but I was me finally. So I was so much more secure in my own desires and the things that I want to do and the things that I want to try. And it was exciting because I felt more well-rounded. I felt like I now had avenues to talk about, you know, anything I wanted. But that was a long path though. That's like, you know, that didn't happen overnight. That happened over the genesis of what Angels and Airwaves was, you know? Blink comes back trying to figure out how do we all communicate? How do we write on the record? Number one, I'm happy that we're able to do it. You know, a lot of bands get back and they can't figure it out. I'm proud that we were able to accomplish that. What I brought to the table musically, you know, it's always pretty easy when you look at the Blink records. You know, if Mark sings, he wrote it, or I sing, I wrote it. Usually it's like that. I was hoping to continue that spirit of no, you know, where I was with Angels and Airwaves, there was no specific box. You know, I at this point, I'm long been doing my own thing, and I've made a handful of albums in that break, and the film, scoring the film that we made. I'm just doing a lot of weird shit. All the tools are at the disposal: synthesizers, MIDI sequencers, vintage, this and that. And to me, it's like it's a whole toolbox. Use whatever wrench or screwdriver you want to use. I don't know if I was on the same page as the other guys. I don't know if they look at that time, if they look at all those tools there and want to use them, you know. But my version of having access to those tools with what I felt Blink needed to do, which was be progressive, you get a song like Ghost on the Dance Floor, which is the first song of the record. I think everyone at that time could agree that that was a great song to lead off with, where it's really fast and it's riffy, but there's synths and there's delay guitars and there's anthemic choruses, but it's really, it's a clever, lyrically it's clever. Feeling the presence of someone who's passed that really affected your life at the time lyrically, that really resonated with Travis, who lost someone on the plane crash. And that was an important song for me to bring to the table. And I think it worked really well. You know, but there's a lot of really great things on that record, and a lot of pieces that weren't that great, because I think it was the clash of two worlds. You know, I'm a very progressive thinker, and Blink is built on a legacy. So, it's hard to figure out who wins that struggle, but that's every rock band that's good. You know, there's always a struggle. There's always, and if there isn't one, usually the music's too tame, you know, and, you can tell it's one guy getting his way the whole way. It doesn't feel like a clash of the Titans like it should feel. You know, to get that song out, you could tell there was a struggle, and you can hear it in the music, and everyone has their stamp on it, and that's what makes it unique. But there's a lot of musicians that like to sit back and go, you know, I tour for the admiration and the money, and I like being famous, and I like the big paychecks, and that's all they ever wanted. That, for me, you know, that's not, I'm after understanding the world we're in and how to make it a better place. And that's what I'm doing to this day with To the Stars. When you look to where I am now, this is a natural evolution of all the things that I learned when I was building a company called Really Likeable People, alongside of Blink 182 for 15, 20 years. We were building really core technology. We built a platform called Mod Life that would help monetize the arts. We were supplying the technology to Pearl Jam and Nine Inch Nails and Kanye and White Stripes to give them the ability to do fan clubs and pay-per-view events and all that stuff. And then on the side, I had this entertainment idea because we were so stuck on building brands and then using software to connect, you know, entities that had fan bases with their fans. I kind of said, well, how do you put all that together and how do you transform art going forward? I wanted to cut out the middleman. I wanted to take what I learned about working with these big bands and monetizing their businesses. I wanted to take what I learned about having really cool brands, surf, skate, snow stuff that was with core audiences, fickle audiences, cool audiences. And how do you put that all together? And To the Stars was kind of like a big soup of all those things coming together. A way to come up with a story, to brand it and you know, give it a name, use technology to go right to the fan base and not have to use other big corporations like record labels and whatever. And also be able to do something that is an evolution of where you know, I see art going, which is the same computer that allows you to write a record in your living room, you can use that same laptop to make a movie or write a book or make a comic book or a million other things, you know. And I just feel that technology is going to make an artist in the future, and pretty soon here, not just make a record in a band or not just be a movie director or not just be an author. You're kind of going to probably do a lot of those things in one. I see kids coming out in the future as an art transmedia project, you know, like, you know, one kid that might have an idea for a book and writes his own soundtrack and puts it all together, and that's kind of what we're doing. I take my ideas about, you know, human life and all the giant ambitious kind of categories of thought that go along with being a human being and looking up to the stars and trying to wonder who we are and where we're going and how this whole place operates. I take these big themes and I say, okay, I want to tell a story about that theme. And so I come up with a title, come with a cool logo, come with a brand. Then I go out and find authors and I write the books with the authors. Then we find cool artists and I help work with the artists to come up with the way the art should work, should there be animations or comic books or whatever. And then we go and find filmmakers, and we might make short films, or we might make feature films and television, all that kind of stuff. So To the Stars has become a record label, a publisher, and a production house all in one. I'm trying to do it all at one place and have a relationship with a fan of that art project for eternity. And that's what To the Stars is. It's a little bit of three or four things all in one, because that's where I see the art going in the future. I just walk around with this thing, and I just go, are you working? Get to work, get to work, get to work, get to work, get to work. Don't like it, get to work.
Deliverance banjo.
Yeah. I wanted a place for all of my talented friends to be. You know, I knew a lot of people that didn't have your traditional upbringing like myself that were very valuable at certain things, and I wanted a place to represent that. My sister has worked at my companies as long as I've had them, and she came over and we started To the Stars, and she was able to take a little bit of blending a brand, because every time we start to do a story, it's a new name, it's a new logo, it's a new brand, it's a new demographic it's talking to and are dealing with, you know. So she understands all that stuff. And thankfully, she just has a really great skill set for that. My goal would be my kids work here and have a home here. You know, I just think it's cool. I thought it'd be fun to do an acoustic record, but the idea of even being on a record label would infuriate me. That you would say, look, I have some songs I want to record. They would say, okay, well, let me run it up the chain, see if we got the money, would we want to allocate the time, and you guys, okay, let's get you back in the studio then in like 6 months. And you're like, fuck, like, I want to go now, you know? I don't like to ask permission to go do art. right when we were starting the company, I said, let's make a book. You know, what's our first book? I sat down at the dining room table and I wrote out a 12-page story about a little astronaut being stuck on the moon. And I called up my friend that was an illustrator that illustrated all the Poet Anderson stuff that we were working on for a couple years. And within 3 weeks, we put out a first book. And it was the coolest thing. It was so liberating. And then all of a sudden, all these like things start popping up, like, the author, Tom DeLonge, the author. And I was like, well, not really. It's a nursery rhyme. It's no different than Blink, you know, just without the music, and it has a little couple drawings. But there's a cadence, and there was a rhyme scheme there, and there's a bit of heart, kind of funny. But I really enjoy having the ability to grab a camera, grab a guitar, or write something and put it down into a book. At any day, we can just go. Just go. I love that freedom. When we started making films and all that stuff, we started collecting various cameras. So we got this guy, and we used it for quite a lot of things. We'll do music videos, short films, commercials, all that different kind of stuff. They made a version that was even smaller. I went out, I have this one project called Secret Machines. I had to go meet a couple guys in the CIA out in Michigan, and the only camera we could sneak along on the trip was something this small, you know? So on this little camera, we followed me up to the point where I had to disappear behind some walls with these guys. I know it sounds crazy, but it's the truth. So this was a really great little camera to bring along that you can, you know, you can film a movie on this thing. In our case, we were filming, a documentary to tell a pretty fantastic story. All this stuff is like a brand new world of gadgetry to play with. Lift behind me, you can see how it goes, and I think people have this tendency to think that the big wide world is like it's full of so much potential and there's so much that can happen and it's so interesting, but I always thought it'd be more interesting if we were awake at night, you know, and we could see the stars above, because we look up now and you just see clouds or you just see a blue sky, but at nighttime you see like planets, you know, and stars and galaxies, and I think the universe is like so big, it's so infinite. And I think that started around seventh grade. I remember I was walking through the library and I had some free time and I said, what the hell, let me go see if there's any books on UFOs. But ever since that point, I kind of go, wow, this is stuff I actually would want to read about. This is weird. This is more interesting to me. But the real interesting thing is after you get into those types of topics, you end up reading books on physics and you end up reading books on history and secrecy and politics. On biology and you know, you start to learn a little bit more about everything, and the next thing you know, the world and the universe is a much stranger place than we ever thought. You know, you got a bunch of people not that long ago that thought the world was flat. You know, you have a bunch of people not that long ago that thought everything in the universe revolved around us. It just takes 100 years to completely change what we think we know about ourselves and where we're at. And that's the kind of stuff that leaves me just like totally fascinated with possibility. So I love being at places like this where you can kind of look out and see a much bigger world than you know. Everything's landscapes for me. So whether I'm like out in the desert, or I'm at the ocean, or I'm hiking, or I'm going on these long walks that I tend to go on. Music is always, I'm trying to basically create a backdrop or a soundtrack to my environment. So Angels and Airwaves became very cinematic like that, because it to me, I always had some type of film running in my head, whether as a true life experience, or even in the studio, we'd put a film up on the television. But music always, you know, these later years of my songwriting, it had to be, it had to be cinematic music. It had to go to something. I couldn't just write a song and have it not go to anything. So going out to the desert,
or seeing a sunset or something like that. It's inspiring. You know, you feel something because you're being hit by more senses than just your ears.
I always complain to people that, you know, I probably should spend more time communicating what I'm doing, why I'm doing it, but I don't. So I think a lot of people come up with these scenarios that I don't care about Blink, or I don't care about being a musician, or, you know, I'm crazy and I'm wearing weird clothing and just doing weird shit, writing books and stuff, or, oh my God, what happened to this man? Books! You should be burning books, not reading them. You know, I don't know, whatever they say. I was working on a batch of songs that were the beginnings of ideas that would have been the next Blink record. It wasn't developed into anything spectacular, but I think you hear little bits and pieces of things that could have been. But I think the most important song out of that batch, and I released them as just demos, odds and ends under my own name, but there's a song called The Invisible Parade. I have a brother that's been in special forces for like 20 years, so he's been to war a few times without anybody knowing. You know, when a ship comes back from war, you know, you got this giant aircraft carrier, you got thousands of people, but when a special forces group comes back, it's a plane, it's 5 a.m, they're exhausted, and there's nobody there to really like give them a warm welcome except for the few family members that are allowed. Like, nobody even knows when they come and go. So the idea of an invisible parade to me was these guys come back and there's no one cheering them on. It all started with a chord progression. I had this chord progression and I played it, and I didn't think we needed anything more than that. Just the music by itself just made me feel something, you know? And every once in a while that happens where you're playing a riff and the riff just speaks to you and then the words come so easily. I call it being an antenna. We're like the great antenna. And if you read anything about consciousness, you're just an antenna and you're picking up this radio wave. I can think back to moments and pictures that inspired me, but when something comes so quick, it's so organic, you kind of go, wow, it was sent to you. You know, I was just a conduit, here it goes, and it comes out. And some of the best things that I've been a part of musically have felt like it just passes through me.
All laid over, this pain will drown out the sun. Mother, I'm coming home. But the war has just begun. All the boys will await the rising tide on a pier with a travel gun. I like the adrenaline, it's like a fucking drug. Mother, I'm coming home.
Growing up the punk scene, being a part of the heritage of punk scene and being such a big part of that word, you'll always get the kids that say, well, you left us, or you're not punk anymore, or this is punk and that's not punk. And it's something only you as an adult that went through it can look back and say, look, your passion is correct, but your definition is wrong. The punk rock ethos exists in a form where kids can adopt it and become unique, become individuals, and celebrate the fact that they're outcasts. And the more of an outcast you become, the better you feel about yourself. You use it for the wrong way when you try to judge other people for not being something. That's, you're missing the point entirely. I remember I was in Australia, and the guy, I know this guy that his first show ever was at the Santa Monica Civic with The Clash. And The Clash, Joe Strummer, the singer of The Clash, walks into the hotel. And My buddy Smitty looks at me, he's, oh my God, it's Joe Strummer. He said, I gotta meet him. All right. So I walk up to him, Mr. Strummer, Tom DeLonge, are playing Blink 182s. He said, my kids love your band. So there's something to talk about. We sit down right there. And so I asked him, I go, well, what is it like being in the Clash? You know, what was that like? And he goes, you know, we used to walk around saying, fuck you, we're the Clash. Fuck you, we're the Clash. And he stops and he goes, but now that I think about it, the Talking Heads were pretty fucking cool. He's all, don't close your mind. Don't close your mind. I was like, oh my God. I was like, wow, that was interesting. Like the king of punk is telling me, like, open your mind up. So 2 days later, we fly to Detroit and it was snowing. And we had a big radio show. Oasis was on this show. And I remember sitting backstage and I got my sideways hat on and I got my fucking nose piercings and crazy shit. And had the doors open up and here come all these guys in trench coats with Beatles haircuts. And first reaction, I was like, oh, they look pretty fucking cool. You know, they look cool. But they're not punk rockers, but whatever. But I'm kind of thinking about what Strummer said. So we go up and we play our show. We weren't that big of a band yet. So we were really fucking rude, like in the funniest way. But like we would take those moments because 17,000 people were watching us that didn't know who we were. And we were playing with other bands. So we would just say really bad shit, like, we should go to jail for the shit we were saying kind of shit. And it was funny. So we get off stage, I'm covered in sweat, the door flies open, and here comes the singer of Oasis, Liam. And he goes, are you guys Blink 182? And I say, yeah. And he pauses, and he goes, you're the best I've seen in America. I'm all, you like us? He goes, I didn't say that, but you're the best I've seen in America. And he slammed the door. And I looked at everyone else, I go, oh my God, that was the most punk rock dude I've ever met in my life. The whole experience, I became the biggest Oasis fan after that, where from that day forward, I stopped listening to punk rock music and I started listening to everything. It was that, from meeting Strummer, having that experience with the Oasis dudes, and walking out of that and the band exploding, I never looked back. And I had my kind of graduation. The whole punk rock thing has nothing to do with music at all. And I think kids miss that point entirely. It has to do with the transformation of being one of the group to an individual and having the balls to say what you want to say, do what you want to do, and follow the path that seems fit, you know? Putting out a song called The Adventure after such a public breakup about my vision of what the world can be and what I want to do with my life and how I choose to see the world was the most punk fucking thing I could ever do. It was a scary thing to do. My biggest issue is I don't actively go out and search for admiration from people or to explain what I'm thinking to people or to validate my actions. So I think what it's the first rule in politics, you're supposed to define the other candidate for them before they can define themselves. And what happens to me is that the fans, the good and the bad, and the good and the bad press, they have to define me before I go out there and do it. And what's happened is they've defined me in such a way, probably, in many places, that is inaccurate. I don't think people know that I listen to scholars every single night before I go to bed. I put it on my nightstand and listen to lectures. I don't think people know that I read books on physics. I don't think people know that I'm totally still fascinated by dick jokes, even though I'm doing some of those things, you know? I don't think people know that my favorite thing in the world outside of being with my family is sitting with my Great Dane and my German Shepherd at Dog Beach, you know, and looking at the sunset. I don't think people know that I'm still completely fascinated with skateboarding. And my son is so into baseball that my way of relating to both is wearing Nike SB, which is Nike skateboarding. I don't think people know that's why I'm wearing Nike in certain Instagram posts. Because it's a way for me to connect with my boy, but also still have a foot in the skateboarding world from which I came. I don't think people know that I'm completely immersed in trying to understand ancient religions and you know, why we are the way we are and why we're warring with each other. And they probably don't know that I think I have a fucking solution. I'm one of those guys that likes to look at the biggest thing ever and go, I bet you I have a way to fix it, which is the biggest joke ever. But that's how my brain thinks. The only thing that takes me away from my maddening thoughts is if I'm learning something. For me, what I do is I learn something and how do I turn that into an art project? So it's a nonfiction book or it's a documentary or it's a lecture. And what does that look like as an animation? What does that look like as a song? What does that look like as a feature film? What does that look like as a story that has all those things in it? That's a challenge. And that keeps my mind at ease. I used to tell Mark and Blink that I admired him because he was always satisfied, you know, with Blink. Like, it satisfied him that it was an incredible thing and we were given such an incredible thing and we were so lucky to have it and all these different things. And I agreed with all those things. But for some reason, it's not stopping my desire to go out and learn more and try more and push myself more and be surrounded by other people that I find are completely fascinating. You know, you're not going to see me do things that are the easy play. It's just not going to happen. You know, you're going to see me do things that I have no business doing. And sometimes it's music, sometimes it's novels, sometimes it's feature films or animations or whatever. Sometimes it's all those things. But at the end of the day, I'm still just a very normal kid from a broken family in a shitty little suburban town. And that should just prove to everybody that they can do it too. Dick Man to Spaceman. That would be the perfect Tom DeLonge t-shirt.
We're pulling from folk and we're pulling from pop, and as a band we've always wanted to be able to do whatever we felt like doing at the moment. I can see the light. Everything that we feel like doing always feels like, all right, cool, yeah, it's just part of the natural progression. But it's all gone.
I feel like I'm interviewing James Bond.
You have that look.
I had this ability to be completely engrossed, and I believe that's how Nick Faldo, the golfer, operated best.
You mimic your heroes. I mean, it's such a powerful thing.
That's the most wonderful thing to go and play when you believe that you're as good as the sport. When you walk out and you know you're gonna have a great day. What a feeling.
Stand by.
Slady.
Row camera. Back row. And action.
In the general election, they predict that you will have a 20-point lead over anyone the GOP throws at you. This time next year, you could have your hand on the Bible, standing on the steps of the Capitol, and just look at you. No!
This season, we wanted to take a political scandal and look at that scandal through different prisms. when you see any kind of scandal in public life, there are always many sides to that particular story.
The story that you've necessarily been told or read about or watched, it's the story that you're only allowed to see.
You raped and beat up a call girl.
I did not do that, Maddie. I swear to God, I'm telling the truth.
The truth is irrelevant in politics, and it doesn't become you.
I think that story that we're telling and getting to dive into is a really fascinating world, and it's very multi-layered, multi-dimensional.
So you're a victim?
Absolutely!
Stop it! Victims don't become president!
And cut. Fantastic.
We're done with Kim and their outfits and everybody. That's good. Thank you very much.
Great. Whoever's trying to frame you, sir, they're still here, watching our every move.
This season of Full Circle does play with the idea of what the costs of being in politics are, what it takes to be a front runner in today's United States.
Senator,
what happened?
Whoa,
are you okay?
And the types of people that might have success in that arena.
If this gets out, if my candidacy is threatened,
it will be my sword that I fall on for you, sir.
You're a good man.
It's very exciting to tell a story like this when it's incredibly relevant. You know, this will be shown during the election campaign. So who knows what's going to happen from any of the candidates between now and November.
We still have everything to lose, right? And this being a setup is even worse than... It's even worse than if you were guilty.
The thing about Trump and Hillary being in the news every day and us doing a political drama, you get to see a little bit behind the veil.
The senator got food poisoning and is being treated by a doctor. The campaign is rock steady and taking ground. Everybody got it. Good. Beat it.
Whatever the news reports are, whatever the story is that's being spun, you get to kind of understand the people behind it who are spinning those stories.
How do you get a card key to a room on a secured floor?
How do you present evidence of WMDs that don't exist in Iraq in front of the United Nations?
I guess anything's possible, right?
Yes, and to our detriment.
When we put our politicians on a pedestal, I think that we forget that no one is necessarily good or bad.
I've been hearing all kinds of rumors there was some kind of hullabaloo with Senator Faulkner and a call girl or something. What?
We have to remember that they're human, and people that are good politicians aren't necessarily good husbands or good wives or good people behind the scenes. And I think this show really depicts that.
44 men who came before me weren't angels, weren't without sin. Overcoming imperfections is the challenge of any man, of any president.
Adultery is an imperfection?
Yes!
No! It's a failure of character.
Who are you running from?
I'm your professor, I'm not your therapist.
You ready for this?
You're a warrior. This is what you were made to do.
Every Saturday on Audience.
My mom and dad are gonna hate this.
You and I are in this together.
Snack on Full Screen.
I want to talk about taking you to the next level.
New original series from today's fastest rising stars.
Guys, you got to realize that swiping right has consequences.
Got the job gun.
Oh, I'm employed.
You're going to do big things out here.
Get ready to snack on Full Screen. Saturdays, only on Audience.
Every single one of my memories takes place within about 100 steps of this very spot.
Are they good memories?
No. They're grand.
Whoa, a train chaser, baby!
I can't for the life of me think of why I stopped coming down here.
Yoo-hoo!
Where'd you find this place?
I inherited it.
I need color and light, not darkness and death. I feel I've had quite enough dark things.
I really do have visions, you know. I have one about you in this case.
My name is Fanny Chanel.
Faites attention, you try to kill me, I try to kill you.
She's fantastic.
Hold on, I have something to tell you and show you. Here is this show about this guy and they're talking.
On Off Camera.
Gin or vodka.
I can't tell the difference anymore, honestly. It tastes like celery, it's gin.
You just never know what people will say. What they'll do.
People are always like, why are you naked all the time? I'm like, it's not as many times as you would think. It doesn't come across my mind that often.
Or where the conversations will go.
I found a lot of stuff out about you while I was preparing for this.
I know what you're talking about. She looked 18 to me.
There was some discussion because we do a photo shoot along with this.
No.
Well, we do.
Well, I'm not doing that.
Well, you signed a thing.
I didn't.
When you're watching a film that you're in, are you focusing on your performance?
Just focused on my hair.
Just your hair.
Now, the series returns.
Dude, that's great!
Off Camera with Sam Jones. New season premieres Monday, September 12th.
We'll shoot you running to your car.
I'll shoot you running to your car.
Only on Audience. And now, a special presentation of Audience Music.
I am Stryker, joined today by Josh and Daniel. They are from Detroit, but they are here on our show today. Junior, guys, welcome to the show.
How's it going?
Thanks for having us.
Anytime. I'm excited you are here. I'm excited that you are playing. How did you guys first meet? Josh, I'll go to you.
Well, we first met just by both being in separate bands in the Detroit scene. And I had seen his band, The Great Fiction, play a bunch of times. And he had been to some of my shows. My band was called The Silent Years. And there was a moment where some friends of mine who were graphic designers were making an album cover for his solo album. And I didn't know that he was making a solo album. And they let me hear a bunch of it. And I was so impressed by it. And I knew that he had made it all himself and played every instrument. And I just found that so interesting. So I just got his number from a friend and called him randomly, and he answered, which now that I know him, I realize how rare it is for him to actually answer his phone. So it was kind of, must have been serendipitous. And I just said, hey, do you want to maybe try and record a song together? And I came over to his, at that time he was living in his grandma's basement, and I went over there and we recorded a song, and it turned out to be Simple Girl, which was our first single that we ever had. So, we just kind of kept on going from there, writing a song every week or so. And
yeah.
Can you tell me how you went from getting together to actually getting on a major label? What was the process for that?
In Detroit, you know, your options are kind of limited to be involved with the music industry. There's a few people who have had success with working with Eminem or working with Kid Rock,